Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining my presentation. So I will give you some facts about the effect of boundary conditions on the cleaning efficiency of bank filtration systems and artificial groundwater recharge systems. So just a few words about both systems. First, the bank filtration system. Here we have a river with surface water, and near the river bank, some water is extracted. You can have a mixture with slope-sided groundwater. This is then abstracted. You can have further treatment. And for artificial groundwater recharge, you will use, for example, surface water. You can have some pre-treatment, and then you will infiltrate this water in an infiltration site. Again, you can have some admixture of natural groundwater. Afterwards, treatment if necessary, and of course, then you can use the water to supply a city. Some example for an artificial groundwater recharge site. This is Basel in Switzerland. Here the water of the River Rhine is used. This is undergoing pretreatment in a rapid sand filtration. Afterwards, it is infiltrated in wooded infiltration sites. And here, the main removal of the organic trace pollutants and DOC is taking place. Finally, you have, of course, the production wells and some treatment afterwards for physical stabilization and disinfection. This is an impression of such a wooded infiltration site in Basel. You see the water is just ponded there on these sites. You have typical vegetation that is adapted to these wet conditions. You have the positive effects of the trees and the bushes in this site. So the water is cooled. That's important in summer, for example. The infiltration rates are very high. It's more than 100 meters per year. And the benefit of this site is a very sustainable site and a very sustainable system. So you don't have to remove the surface of the infiltration ponds. You have biological activities, earthworms, for example, bacteria, and there's no clogging, so the infiltration capacity is sustainable. Some words about the relevance of both systems in the Rhine catchment. In a recent study, we investigated the importance of several water sources to the total water abstraction, and here we see in the Rhine catchment, mainly surface water is used. So we have, for example, lake water, but then we have some treatment. This is bank filtrate and artificially recharged groundwater, and it's approximately 20% for each treatment. Now some words about the removal of the trace pollutants and DOC. So we investigated several boundary conditions and the effect on the removal of trace pollutants and DOC. So I will give you some data about the temperature effect, about the compound structure. This is not a boundary condition, but it is important too, we noticed. Then the redox conditions, the retention time, and the initial concentration in the surface water, and the discharge of the rivers where we take the surface water from. So the removal is then just the difference between the water or the concentration in the surface water that we infiltrate and the water that we will extract afterwards, after treatment in the subsurface. Now, the temperature has a very high range when you take a look on the surface waters. Here are some examples from German sites. So when you take a look to the right, this is artificial groundwater recharge in the upper Rhine Valley. And here you have a very big temperature range from 3 to 26 degrees in the surface water. And after the artificial groundwater recharge, this range is reduced to 6 to 17 degrees. So that's positive effect for the customers. Nobody wants to drink hot water in the summer, of course. A similar effect can be observed in riverbank filtration. this is on the left side, and you see, depending on the site where you are, you have different ranges of temperature, but mostly you have a range of approximately 20 degrees or more in the surface water, and depending on the site and the retention time, you can reduce it to, well, up to 1 degree in the water you abstract, so that's quite good, and you have nice cold water, and you have no risk of bacterial regrowth in your supply net. When you compare it to groundwater, of course, the retention times are very long, and the range of temperature that you have in the water you abstract is very low. It's mostly just 1 degree. So when we take a look, what happens when we have this huge range of temperature, does it affect artificial groundwater recharge? This is an example for DOC removal in an artificial groundwater recharge site. And you can, the bars, they represent the relative elimination, the percentage of the initial concentration removed. And you see in pink, that is degradation and sorption. This is the true removal by the treatment system. And then in blue, this is the amount that is, or the percentage that is removed by dilution. So we can see in spring, we have mostly degradation and sorption, but it is not exceeding 40% together with dilution. That's not too much, but it's sufficient in this site. In summer, the rates increase, and we have more degradation and sorption due to the biological activity that is increased by higher temperature. And we have, depending on the infiltration regime, a little dilution. But when we take a look to fall, then the temperature is already declining. And I must admit, there is less infiltration. When you have a lot of rain, you need less infiltration. And then you see there is more dilution. But here we can see there is some impact on the removal of DOC by temperature. Now we change to bank filtration sites. And here we have some trace pollutants. Now you see the removal efficiency for several trace pollutants. And the red bars that will represent high temperature in the surface water, and the blue bars low temperature. So the difference is 15 degrees. And we should see some effect because that is almost the biggest temperature you can observe. So you see it's always a pair of three bars in the picture. And from left to right, the retention time is increasing here in this site. So we took a look on several retention times. Now for the 1.5 naphthalene desulfonate, you can see there is little removal, it's not more than 35-36% at all at the high temperature. And when we have the low temperature, the removal is almost not existent. You have no removal at low temperature. But now when we compare this to a similar compound that is structurally just a little bit different, that's a 1.7 naphthalene desulfonate, then we see the removal is much higher, it's almost 100%, and we have no effect of temperature. Then there is another compound, 1.135 trisulfonate now, and here we see again there is an effect. At higher temperature we have considerable removal, but at low temperature not. Well, now let's go to iopamidol, that's some X-ray contrast media. And here we see the same. We have a good removal of up to 60% at high temperature, but no removal at low temperature. But again, a structurally related compound, Johexol, another X-ray contrast media. Here we see we have almost 100% of removal regardless of the temperature in the surface water. And similar good removal for the complexing agent NTA and for pharmaceutical diclofenac. So here we can't see any effect of temperature. Now now I just come back shortly to the structure. Here you see on the left, that's the naphthalene 1.5 disulfonic acid. This is a rather persistent compound. Here we could observe some effect of temperature. If you're going to the right, there are some easily degradable compounds, the 1.7 disulfonic acid and the 1 sulfonic monosulfonic acid. Here they were always removable to 100%. So no effect of temperature, and it is quite remarkable that these small differences in the structure cause such big effects. The same was observed in the laboratory, not in the field sites, but in the laboratory too. So here the blue line and dots represent the 1.5 naphthalene disulfonate, which is rather persistent. You can see here, even after 30 days of degradation experiment in the laboratory, no removal was observed, but we had a rapid removal of the monosulfonates. Now we shift to the redox conditions. This is an example from artificial groundwater recharge site again. And here you can see on the V-axis, the consumed dissolved oxygen, and on the X-axis, the DOC, this was eliminated in this site. You see there's some relation between both parameters. So you can conclude there's an oxidation of the DOC that was removed. And so the oxygen is important, that you can have some oxidation. When there's no oxygen, you won't be able to oxidize the DOC. Now for some trace pollutants, we go to a bank filtration site now. We surveyed several bank filtration sites in Germany and in the United States. And here you can see the removal efficiency of several compounds depending on the redox conditions in the aquifer. So on the left, in the blue bars, that's a site near River Ruhr. And here you can see even very persistent compounds like carbamazepine, eupamidol or amidotrisoic acid are almost completely removed. When we then go to the pink bars at River Elbe, here you have a bit less reducing conditions, and you see some compounds are still removed, but others showed less removal. When we go to Great Miami River and finally to the Rhine, you see in the aerobic sites at the Rhine, we have no removal of carbamazepine and amidotrisoic acid. Some removal for sulfamethoxazole and eupamidol. So it is important to know the compound and the effects that certain redox conditions will have on the removal of certain compounds. You can't say every compound will be removed at a certain redox system the same. Now, some impact of retention time was observed. This is again a bank filtration site. And here we noticed that the removability of a compound depends on its degradability. So on the left, that's Johexol, and you see it is very rapidly removed, so you can't see an effect, it's just gone. But when you take a look to the more persistent complexing agent EDTA, then you see there's an impact of retention time. The longer the retention time is, the more of the compound will be removed. Now we investigated the impact of the initial concentration in the surface water and the discharge of the river. So we compared several data sets. So on the left, down in the left edge, you can see the temperature in both data sets was similar, the dissolved oxygen, electrical conductivity, but the discharge was almost double. So we I just put the gauge data here. Now we see for DOC, there is no difference. You see from the left to the right, the surface water concentration in the Rhine and some observation wells with increasing retention time from 12 to 60 days. And you can see at low discharge, at similar concentration as at high discharge, you have considerable removal. And this removal is bigger than at high discharge. This means we have some impact of the low discharge and the removal is bigger when we have low discharge and it is smaller when we have high discharge. The effect is getting a bit smaller with increasing retention time then. Now another example, this is now amidotrisoic acid, a trace compound. And here we see there is a little difference between low and high discharge initial concentration, and we have big variation and there is almost no removal, or there is no removal, and it does not depend on the discharge conditions we have or on the initial concentration now. On another side, we observed interesting effects because at low discharge, the concentration was much higher than at high discharge, and all the other parameters like temperature were the same, but the discharge was almost double. Here we can see for sulfamethoxazole, at low discharge, we had some removal, but at high discharge, at lower concentration, there was no more removal. The compound just stayed where it was. Up on the right, there's again the 1.5 naphthalene disulfonate. You can see more or less the same. At low discharge and high concentration, you have some removal, not too much, but some removal. And at high discharge, with low concentration, there's no removal at all. For carbamazepine, which is quite persistent, you see almost no effect. But then for sotalol, that is quite rapidly removable, you see you can't observe the effect because the compound is rapidly degradable and you won't observe the effect in this case. Now we made some laboratory experiments again. And here we can see complexing agent NTA that is readily removable. And here you see with the pink bars, that's the highest concentration. This is quite fast removed. And with the light blue and dark blue, this is decreasing initial concentration. And you can see it takes much longer for biodegradation when the concentration is lower. So this is the same as we observed in the field. Then we have some beta blockers here. So again, the same effect. They are not so easily degradable. So the effect takes longer to take place, but you can see the red and the pink lines, metoprolol, you have less effect, but for sotalol, you have some effect, but it takes 30 days until you observe a bigger difference. So final example is carbamazepine. This is hardly degradable, so it does not matter whether you have low or high concentration. It is just persistent, it will stay there. To conclude from this impact of the initial concentration, the concentration effect decreases with the persistence of a compound. And at rather short retention times, smaller than 35 days, sometimes you won't observe an effect. Now to conclude, boundary conditions have an important impact on the removal of trace pollutants and of DOC. So the effect of temperature is for most compounds low, but low temperature can impair the removal of non-easily biodegradable compounds and of DOC. Then the initial concentration and the discharge, they had little impact in the field, but we could observe some impact on the laboratory scale. So here again, it depends on other settings too. For example, maybe the nutrient availability. A big impact had the compound structure. That's very important. And you should be very careful when you say, well, we have a class of compounds, and this class of compounds is usually removed at oxic or anaerobic or whatever conditions, because there can be remarkable differences between compounds that are structurally closely related to each other. Of course, redox conditions had a very big impact. And finally, the retention time has some impact, but there are still some compounds that are not degradable at all. So effects of boundary conditions can only be observed when the compounds are not easily biodegradable. Both bank filtration and artificial groundwater recharge are robust treatment steps, and most changes in the boundary conditions did not cause an effect for most compounds. So remaining redox conditions and the compound structure were identified as the most important effects or boundary conditions. And finally, the prolonged retention time can enhance the removal of some persistent compounds when you are lucky. That is something you can try. Okay, so thank you for your attention.